Welcome to the Knowing Neurons interview series. I'm Jillian Shaw, and my guest today is science writer Steve Silberman, the celebrated author of Neurotribes, The Legacy of Autism, and the Future of Neurodiversity. In addition to being a New York Times best-selling writer and recipient of the Samuel Johnson Prize for Nonfiction, Steve's TED Talk on the Forgotten History of Autism has been viewed well over a million times. As a contributor and editor at Wired, Steve Silberman has created thought-provoking and well-researched content that is diverse in scope, articles like The Geek Syndrome, in which he explores the rise in diagnosis of autism among children in Silicon Valley. Welcome. I'm thrilled you could join us.
Oh, I'm thrilled to be here. Thank you so much for asking.
In line with sort of making room in society for people who interact differently or have different ways of thinking or processing or socializing, can you think of some really critical advances in the realm of technology and behavioral training that has helped autistic children find ways to communicate and not necessarily just conform to the standard way we operate in the tech world or in business or in society?
Well, I'll give you a big example. The iPad has turned out to be a huge boon for autistic kids. And why is that? It's not just because it's a graphical user interface. It's not just because it's portable. It's also because it's cheaper than a lot of the dedicated, what are called AAC devices for alternate and augmentative communication. Like, there have been devices that allow autistic kids to type to speak. And they use proprietary software, and they're kind of hard to look around. They're not stylish, you know. And so the iPad turned out to be a convergence of good things. You know, it's definitely not a panacea. It doesn't even always replace AAC devices in the lives of kids. But it makes a certain level of communication much more accessible to people with less money than dedicated AAC devices. You know, that turned out to be something that wasn't even done specifically for autism, but it turned out to be really, really good for autistic people. And what I find is that when society makes room for people who are differently abled or, there's nothing wrong with the word disabled, that you can actually make the world better for everyone in ways that no one could have predicted.
That's beautiful. So I would have loved to have been a fly on the wall for your conversations with Lorna Wing. But the history of autism goes back even earlier. I want people to read your book, so by no means will we cover all of it today, but could you give people a brief teaser, maybe take us back to 1943? Could you write to one of the uncanny synchronicities of science about Leo Kaner and Hans Asperger and what they were uncovering, and just this truly amazing story of Asperger's discoveries and some of what was going on in Nazi Germany? It's an amazing and compelling scientific story.
Thank you. Well, the short version is this. For decades, autism was considered to be the discovery of Leo Kaner. Leo Kaner was one of the first child psychiatrists in America. He worked at Johns Hopkins Hospital. He actually helped invent the field of child psychiatry in America. And he published a paper in 1943 that was basically the first paper written in English that saw autism as a distinct condition and sort of outlined the features of that condition. So for decades, Leo Kaner has gotten credit to be the father of the autism diagnosis. But what I found by going back earlier into the 1930s was that the real discoverer of autism was Hans Asperger and his colleagues at the University of Vienna. And Hans Asperger's clinic was different than Leo Kaner's. It was, in a sense, for kids and families who were in a more desperate situation. Hans Asperger's clinic was sort of a place of last resort where a kid would go if they had been expelled from multiple schools, or perhaps they'd get referred there by the juvenile courts as a disciplinary measure. Asperger was highly motivated to basically help find ways of turning these kids' lives around so they could succeed. And what Asperger and his colleagues developed was highly innovative in that it wasn't just a clinic where a kid would get dropped off for a round of tests and evaluated and then, you know, dumped back with the family. It was like a residential school, so there were actually classes. Asperger would even read poetry to the children. The environment was very, very comfortable. They were encouraged to just sort of hang out with each other if they wanted to. And then the whole time, the staff would observe them very closely. So it gave the staff a chance to really learn about what these kids' lives were like, even when the kids were at ease. And That enabled Asperger and his staff to develop a very humane and comprehensive picture of autism. And what they discovered is what we would now call the autism spectrum. Asperger framed autism as a very, very broad concept, and he wrote about kids who were both profoundly disabled and would probably never be able to survive outside of institutions. He wrote about a former patient of his who became an astronomy professor, despite the fact that he was still what Asperger called blatantly autistic. So, in other words, the kid had not, like, grown out of autism or, you know, been miraculously cured. He was still autistic. So Asperger had this very broad and sort of colorful conception of autism, but there was a big problem for both Asperger and his patients, which was that after 1938, when the Germans marched in to annex Vienna, Asperger was working for Nazis. So his mentor at the university, who actually gave him the job, was one of the biggest Nazis in Vienna. And not only that, the Jewish colleagues of Hans Asperger were forced to leave Vienna or were taken to concentration camps or committed suicide. Not only that, the children in Asperger's care and all over Germany and Austria became targets of a secret extermination program run by the Nazis, where they were actually targeting kids with hereditary conditions like schizophrenia and epilepsy. And if you think about it, you know, there was no word for autism yet, although Asperger and his colleagues were calling it autism internally as far back as the mid-1930s. But a kid with autism would have presented probably either as someone with epilepsy, if they had seizures, or schizophrenia. Those were the two biggest groups of kids who were exterminated by the Nazis. So Asperger was then suddenly in a very, very difficult position. And so what he did was, in 1938, he gave the very first public talk on autism history to an audience of Nazis, in which he said that these kids don't only have, like, really profound impairments and challenges, they also have special gifts. And furthermore, he said that their gifts and their impairments, as he put it, create a harmonious personality. In other words, he didn't see them as kids who had these gifts, but then, you know, there was also this terrible thing that they had autism, and if we could only get rid of this terrible thing, then the kids would be fine. He didn't put it that way. He framed it in a very complex way, making the argument that these kids' lives were worthwhile, and until my book came out, nobody knew exactly, like, why did he have to prove that the kids' lives were worthwhile? Well, he had to, because the Nazis were exterminating them.
Yeah, actively. That part of the book, yeah, it brought me to tears. It's an intense description.
Really intense. And so Asperger was in a very difficult position. In fact, I would argue that he was in a position where he had to save his own life as well. So what I discovered is that two of Asperger's closest colleagues, both his chief diagnostician, this guy George Frankl, and this clinician Ani Weiss, were forced to leave Austria because they were Jewish. It turns out that Frankl... It's also possibly true that Weiss as well, I've just learned, were rescued by Leo Kanner. Leo Kanner was Jewish, and he was helping to rescue German Jewish and Austrian Jewish clinicians from the Holocaust and get them jobs in America. Leo Kanner and his wife, June, would actually find jobs for these people. So the job that they found for George Frankl was being the head of this children's clinic that was related to Johns Hopkins. What Leo Kanner always said was that it was serendipity that allowed him to discover autism. Well, actually what happened was this guy named Donald Triplett arrived at Kanner's office in 1938, and Kanner didn't know what to make of his behavior. And so he sent him to this place called the Child Study Home, where there was a guy there who happened to know exactly what was going on with this guy, Donald Triplett, George Frankl. And it was because George Frankl had already seen dozens, if not, you know, more than 100 kids with autism by that point. So it's George Frankl who wrote the clinical descriptions of Donald T's behavior and also Connor's second autistic patient. And so, you know, I propose in NeuroTribes that the two of them, particularly because they used to do what was called public clinics together, where they would basically, like, go to a high school and kids would bring their kids to get evaluated. Imagine that, like, you know, both the father of the autism diagnosis in America and Asperger's chief diagnostician examine your kid at the local high school. So it's obvious that Connor and Frankel must have talked about autism, and that Frankel was bringing with him years of experience. But unfortunately, Connor was, you know, not able to find a job for Frankel or his wife, Annie Weiss. And so they ended up sort of disappearing into the sunset. And because Connor never mentioned Asperger's work, and people say, well, why didn't he? Well, you know, Asperger's paper was written in German, Connor's native language. Well, it was published in this obscure neurology journal, one that Connor cited several times. It could be that it was Asperger's Nazi associations that chilled out Connor's feelings about him. But, you know, this is all speculation. But
that's such a compelling link between the Asperger lab and in the age of scientific sharing, where there's still a lot of guarded secrecy about findings. You wonder if there were personal egos and wanting to be the first to uncover certain things.
The reason why it's a particularly fateful thing is because Connor described autism completely differently than Asperger did, in that Connor framed it very narrowly as a very rare form of childhood psychosis. And then when Connor's paper was initially published, it was actually virtually ignored. Like, hardly anybody wrote about it. But a few years later, Connor discovered on a way to get more attention to his work, which was to blame autism on bad parenting.
Makes me cringe, yeah.
Yeah, and he was immediately quoted in Time magazine as saying, these children have been kept in a refrigerator that didn't defrost. So the phrase refrigerator mother became, you know, the biggest, not just cliche, but weapon against autism parents. And this had an absolutely catastrophic effect on both autistic people and their families, because Connor's recommended course of treatment for autism became institutionalization, to remove the child from the allegedly toxic family environment, and also to protect the siblings from the allegedly harmful effects of having, you know, this kid around. And I actually spoke to parents who were told by their pediatrician or usually psychiatrist to remove the child's pictures from the family album and never mention them again. And so people say, like, why didn't I ever hear about autism when I was young? Well, the families were actually discouraged from talking about their kids. Not only that, the diagnosis was very, very hard to get. You basically had to get it from Connor or somebody in his network. And Connor bragged that he turned 9 out of 10 children who were referred to his office for a diagnosis of autism away without giving them a diagnosis, because it was in Connor's professional interest to frame this condition that he was allegedly the father of very narrowly. And, you know, there are good scientific reasons for that, because he wanted it to be very crisply defined. But the problem is that as time went on, people still think that Connor and Asperger defined different clinical populations. And what I found was that Asperger actually admitted in his 1938 speech that he was only telling the Nazis about his, quote-unquote, most promising cases. And there are obvious reasons for that, because the ones who were considered less promising would have been sent to a death camp. So Asperger had reasons to emphasize his, quote-unquote, most promising cases that had nothing to do with the diversity in his clinical population. You know, most people think, oh, well, Connor's syndrome, that was something different from Asperger's syndrome. That's the real autism. That's the nonverbal kid who puts poo on the wall. And, well, it turns out that one of them became a Navy meteorologist with a family. One of them became a composer of pieces for a symphony orchestra. No. So it's obvious that both groups were more diverse than either clinician really ended up admitting. I mean, Connor did write about those, you know, like the meteorologist and the composer and another guy who was very gifted at math, but his name tended to become synonymous with what is usually called, although I don't like this label, low-functioning autism.
Sure. Speaking of scientific conundrums, I'm interested in this idea of diagnosis. And so we have in 1975 numbers in the range of 1 in 5,000 kids. Today, it's something on the order of 1 in 68. You mentioned the idea that Connor was turning people away and not diagnosing widely and broadly. And certainly we've had Andrew Wakefield's retracted theory linking autism to vaccines. But
keep in mind, he never retracted it.
No, you know? You're right. You're absolutely right. Yeah, he framed it out.
Yeah, as a martyr.
But my question being, can you talk about rising rates of autism prevalence currently? So we've spoken about genetics, we've spoken about the possibility of diagnosis, but you talk about this idea of the perfect storm of this increase in prevalence. What are you referring to there?
Well, here's the thing. You know, it's like you have all these graphs, some of which were published by the largest autism fundraising organization in the world, Autism Speak.
Sure.
All right. Why did that graph rise so steeply? And as you mentioned, I've called it a perfect storm. It was a perfect storm of the broadening of the diagnostic criteria so that more kids and eventually teenagers and adults could get the diagnosis. The notion of an autistic adult like Temple Grandin that was unheard of as, you know, as recently as the mid-80s, like people didn't think in terms of autistic people becoming adults and still being autistic because it had been so strictly defined by Connor as a form of childhood psychosis. In fact, I believe the title of his big anthology of his own writing on autism was called Childhood Psychosis, actually.
Yeah.
Anyway, for years, it had been very strictly defined by Connor as this form of childhood psychosis. Now, after Lorna Wing and the people who edited the DSM-4, I believe it was, well, it was, the main changes were made in the DSM in 1986 and 1994, which was, you know, precisely when the so-called autism epidemic began. So the gateway to diagnosis became much broader because of the changes in the DSM. Then Rain Man put the first autistic adult that virtually anyone had ever seen on the screen. Many of them were in institutions. But what I find, like Raymond Babbitt, you know, at the end of Rain Man, he has to go back in the institution because he's not considered able to live in the outside world. What I find very poignant, and I write about in the book, is that Rain Man was based on several real-life autistic models, one of whom I actually spent a couple days with. He's a delightful middle-aged man now. Still very autistic, but incredibly sweet and very happy because he has a supportive community. What I thought was very poignant was none of those real-life models were in institutions. So in other words, people say, you know, it's become sort of stylish to say, well, Raymond Babbitt, he was actually more able than most autistic people because he had these savant abilities. Actually, he was less able in some ways than the real-life models he was based on because he could not survive outside of an institution where they were able to. So Rain Man suddenly, you know, I was told by one of the founders of the main autism parents organization in America, she said Rain Man did more overnight than we were able to do in 25 years in terms of public awareness of autism. So Rain Man completely transformed the world for autistic people and their families and enabled clinicians, teachers, pediatricians, neighbors suddenly knew what an autistic person looked like, so it vastly increased public awareness. The other thing that happened was that these clinical instruments that allow clinicians sort of gave a standard screening instrument to screen for autism, those came out too. Before that, you sort of had to have been schooled in the Connor method. And so it was like these three huge things happened all at once. The diagnosis became much broader and more inclusive. Suddenly everybody knew what autistic people look like, and then these clinical screening instruments became available. And so it was, as I say, a perfect storm, and Lorna Wing was certainly not surprised when the rates of diagnosis went up.
That's one of the most compelling descriptions of why the rates have gone up that I've heard. Steve, I haven't even gotten through half of my questions, but I want to encourage people to read the book. We're actually going to be giving out a signed copy to our subscribers on Knowing Neurons. But I wanted to shift the tone a little bit and ask you about you and your career as a science writer. I know a lot of our listeners are interested in science writing. How did you become a science writer, and what new books are in the pipeline? What do we have to look forward from you next?
Well, I wish there were a bunch of new books in the pipeline. What's happening is this book was so intense. Like,
yeah.
My publisher thought that it would take me a year and a half to write. Once I figured out that the basic timeline of autism's discovery was wrong, I knew I would have to document that really carefully. And
yes,
a year-and-a-half book project and a year-and-a-half hiatus from Wired turned into a complete change of life and career in that I spent, well, basically really like 6 years, in a sense, writing the book, so it was totally all-encompassing. The whole world has changed so much since I started writing the book. So I don't know what my future in terms of magazine journalism is. I mean, I know I'm going to be doing it, but it's probably not going to be exclusive to Wired like I used to be. So in terms of how I got into being a science writer, I did not take a traditional path. I did not go through, you know, the Columbia Journalism School or whatever. The thing is that I was interested in science from a very young age One of the reasons why I write about young science geeks and neurotribes is because I was one myself. I was a geeky kid. I used to carry around books of pictures of clouds so I could identify clouds. I had
Wonderful.
Yeah. I had a mineral collection with, by the way, a piece of uranium in it. Like, that's
Whoa.
How old I am. Like, there, you know, we had, like, uranium in our mineral collections back then. I had chemistry sets. You know, so from a very young age, I was into both science and science fiction. Then I became interested in writing. In college, interestingly enough, I focused mostly on poetry because I thought it was the most intense form of language study and most intense, like, sort of way of paying attention to language. And so I ended up becoming a student of the poet Allen Ginsberg, who wrote
right.
this well-known poem called Howl. I ended up becoming his teaching assistant. So in a way, I kind of took a detour from science into poetry. But then when the internet came along, I was hired as a senior editor at Hotwired, which was Wired magazine website, and it was one of the first commercial websites, and we helped develop one of the first online news services that was native to the web, and it was called Wired News. And I gravitated there towards science because it was my personal interest. And so I started writing like a story a day, like hundreds of stories for Wired News, and many of them were about science. And I eventually got poached from the website to the magazine. So it was very natural for me to start writing about science for Wired magazine, and Geek Syndrome was one of the first pieces that I wrote for the magazine. So, you know, I'm skipping over a lot.
Sure.
Years of waiting on tables to support myself, so there's no shame in that.
No shame in that.
But yeah, so I took a fairly unusual path into science writing.
Absolutely. And then last question. You spoke a little bit about the response that you had when you first came out with Geek Syndrome, but what has been one of the most meaningful reactions to the book and someone who's reached out that really reinforced, you know, the 6 years that you worked on it?
There are so many, I hardly know what to say, but one of the interesting responses that I got was from an autism clinician who had started working in the 1940s. So she was clearly one of the first autism specialists in the world. Her name is Steen Levy. And she told me that as late as the late 1980s, by the time she would see a kid to give them a diagnosis, the kid had already been through 10 other medical specialists who had no idea what they had. So if you want to know why, you know, until fairly recently, autism was considered not only rare, but specific to, you know, like Connor theorized that it was a disorder specific to upper middle class white families. Think about how many families of color or families in poverty could afford to doctor shop through 10 specialists to get their kids a diagnosis. And in many areas of the world, that's still true, that people of color and people without money can never afford to get their kid a diagnosis. And so it was not surprising to me at all when she told me that, because when people continue to talk about vaccines or environmental factors, yes, you know, is there any possible true rise in autism? Sure. Parents are getting older these days before they have their first kid. There's some, I think, solid evidence that older parents, you know, may have a higher chance of having an autistic kid. But before we even get into all that, we have to address communities that have been traditionally underserved, like families of color and families in poverty. And so her statement to me that the kids had already been seen by 10 specialists before they even got to her makes it clear to me how much work we still have to do to improve access to diagnosis for families.
Absolutely. Steve, I think that's a wonderful quote and important message to end on. I want to thank you so much for your time and honestly for your research, for having done such an elegant job of really unpacking the history of autism and helping society move forward with being more open and inclusive. So with that, I want to thank you, and I'm excited to have this come up on our blog.
Great. Thank you so much. I'm really honored that you asked.